Hi. Greetings across whatever you watch things on. You have arrived early at the Silent Comedy Watch Party, where we are streaming to you 100% live. This is actually happening right now. On Sunday, November 1st. It's still 2020, but it's November 1st. It's 3 o'clock here. It's about to be 3 o'clock here. It's about to be 8 or 9 o'clock outside of the U.S. I know they jumped around for some of you guys last week, and but we're back on our regular schedule.
We gained
a little bit anyway, and so we're getting ready, and we'll be up starting our show. But as always, if you've just discovered our show, we always go live a few minutes ahead of time, so you know you've arrived at the right place, but we still have a little time to go.
You've got about 5 minutes if you're on the East Coast with us on this drippy, chilly day on the East Coast. You have time to microwave some popcorn, perhaps, some nice warm popcorn. If you're on the West Coast, our friends, maybe you're having a little lunch with us today, and our friends in Europe and Scandinavia, maybe a cocktail or a nightcap or some hot cocoa and some biscuits. And our friends all over the rest of the world, we're so happy you're with us today. Maybe you're having breakfast with us. So happy Sunday, everybody.
Happy Sunday, Mona. Yeah, thanks. And so we'll start in a few minutes, and here's a little music to occupy you while you get your virtual cinema seat all set. Yes, you have arrived at the Silent Comedy Watch Party, episode 32. Yes, we're in our seventh month of doing these weekly live stream shows, streaming to you live for free here on YouTube. And we're so glad to join you and for you to join us, and we're going to have this movie visit together. We'll be starting in just a minute or two. Just so you know, if you ever are watching the show and you notice we're like incredibly way out of sync, just refresh your browser. That tends to clear up.
That usually fixes it.
Yeah. It's the equivalent of moving the rabbit ears on your TV. That'll clear the picture up, or it ought to anyway. Here's a couple more minutes. We'll be starting in a couple of minutes. Thanks for tuning in. See you shortly. Thank you. Yes, happy Sunday. Welcome to the Silent Comedy Watch Party.
Happy Sunday, everybody.
Thank you, Mona, and thanks for turning the lights on so I can see you. Welcome to the Silent Comedy Watch Party. I'm Ben Modell, silent film historian and accompanist, but not necessarily in that order, welcoming you to our live stream. We are here, my wife Mona Ellen and I, here
Hi,
in our apartment, and shortly Steve Massa and his wife Susan in their apartment. We are streaming to you live from New York.
Our living room.
I guess from our living room. Live from New York, as the expression goes. And we're so glad we could visit with you and you with us today. So let's wave hello. Good to see you. I hope you're okay. I hope that your health and the stress and everything else that's going on right now, that you're holding up all right. This is episode 32, our 32nd episode. We are streaming to you live from New York. It is November 1st, 2020. And I did some cheap math, and I realized that out of the 31 episodes we've already done, that means we've streamed out about 80 comedy shorts. And so if you need something to take your mind off of what's going on Tuesday every once in a while, just go over to YouTube and dial up one
Check
of our old shows.
Episode.
There's plenty to binge watch, but we're so glad you're here. I want to thank everyone who sent in messages or posted comments or shared links or retweeted things. It's not just about, oh, we need to get the word out so we get our numbers up, but one of the things we've read so much about is that having this show to watch has been helpful as stress relief or whatever. And so if you're able to help get the word out to spread the dose of laughs we serve up every week,
that's why we do it.
That's what we're here for. So we want to thank you for helping spread the joy that comes from these movies made 100 years ago that are still funny today, in the way that only silent film can entertain. I want to thank anybody who, if maybe you, sent in a contribution. You know, we're set up on Patreon and PayPal and SquareUp and Venmo. If you're able to and you're so inclined, we appreciate it. It's not why we set this up. This is about sharing these wonderful films with you. We've heard from people all over the planet, and there's so many more countries that we hear from, and even the YouTube analytics say that there are people in India watching the show.
So exciting!
Yeah, so we love hearing from people. If you haven't written in, posted a comment or anything, let us know. You know, that you're watching. We know there are kids and families are watching, and we know from what we see on television and in the news that different parts of the planet are shutting down or shutting back down. We hope you're safe. We've got a great show for you today. I want to thank I don't want to get ahead of myself here. I want to thank Marlene Weissman, who does our graphics every week. So thank you so much, Marlene. Thank you to Steve's wife, Susan, for wrangling him and getting everything lined up on their end. And also thank you to Crystal Kai, our associate producer, who helps keep me on track and keeps me from forgetting a lot of the stuff that I need to pull together to share these wonderful films with you. And yeah, I think that's everything. I even remember to wave. I put the word wave in big letters because I kept forgetting. So that part is done. So
we're so happy you're here.
Yeah, we're just so happy you're here. Thanks for coming over to watch old movies with us. Here is Steve. Hey, Steve, how are you?
Hey, Steve.
Hello, I remembered to wave too. I saw your
note. Yeah, here we go. Here we go. Yeah, there we go.
There's a big
Yeah.
Hi,
thanks,
everybody.
Good to see you, Steve.
See you too. I'm glad everyone's doing well. I hope everyone out there who's watching is doing well. And trying to remain stress-free is kind of the stress goes up this week.
Yeah, exactly. So
keep laughing, keep smiling.
Yeah, exactly. So we've got a great. This is our week where we show two real comedies, and we've got a really good pairing of films today. One of them is really rare, and the other one is it's been around, but it doesn't get shown often, or a lot of people haven't seen it. So to set up our first film, Steve, why don't you tell our friends here about The Village Chestnut?
Okay. Well, like Ben said, our first short is The Village Chestnut, and this is a 1918 Max Sennett comedy. And it stars two of his best known and, you know, very iconic performers, Louise Fazenda and Chester Conklin. Now, as I said, this film came out in 1918, and Max Sennett had just left the Triangle Film Corporation. This is a page from the Paramount press book for The Village Chestnut. Sennett had been distributing his films through Triangle, along with D.W. Griffith and Thomas Ince, and things hadn't been working out so well with Triangle, so he decided to leave. And when he left, he left the name Keystone with Triangle. Triangle decided that was the most important thing, and if he was going to leave, they were going to keep the brand name Keystone. And Sennett, it said, made them think that was the case, but he really didn't care about the name Keystone at that point. He wanted to keep Max Sennett Comedies, and he wanted to keep his studio, and he wanted to keep his people, which he ended up doing. So in 1918, he became Max Sennett Comedies, and he distributed his films. He set up a deal with Paramount. So from 1917 through 1921, he distributed his comedies through Paramount Pictures. But unfortunately, this is a period where a good deal of the films are missing, unfortunately. So The Village Chestnut is a rare example of his Paramount comedies. And this film was considered lost for many years, but it was found, nitrate print was found at the Filmmuseum in the Netherlands. So it's been restored, and it was made available by the National Film Preservation Foundation. So it's a great film, and it has a lot of the regular Sennett people turn up during the film. But it's a lot of fun. So yeah, I think we should go ahead.
Yeah, it is a lot of fun. It's really interesting that there is this period where seeing anything from Sennett from 1918 and 19 is really really hard.
Very
and
rare.
So, yeah. And so when Steve said that the National Film Preservation Foundation made it available, that means that they have hey, where is the button for this? Oh, I didn't set it up. Okay, but there. Oh, here it is. Here it is. The National Film Preservation Foundation has what they call a virtual screening room. They've had this for a number of years, and you can see that. And this is just the stuff that they have scanned and posted from the iFilm project. But they have several hundred titles are available on their website. And actually, I scored this film for them.
And I wrote the website.
And so Steve wrote the notes. So we're biased or anything.
No, not at all. But there's a number of them that I've done the notes or Ben has done the score that they've been doing recently.
Yeah.
But there's some really wonderful. We showed one of the previous films we showed that the Preservation Foundation has up is Her First Kiss with Ethel Tear. That was the one that they funded the restoration as well.
Yeah. Yeah, so we're grateful to the National Film Preservation Foundation for this, as well as to iFilm and the Library of Congress. Just so you know, because like Steve said, this film is a good deal of it is lost. So a little of this era is lost. The very beginning and the very end of the film are missing, but we're happy to see what we have. The intertitles that you'll see were created, I believe, by iFilm, so they're not the original. Titles, they're translated from the Dutch language titles. So just so you know what you're seeing, it's translated, may have gone from English to Dutch and then back. And just so you know, one basic plot point that kind of threw me and Steve at first, but we realized that takes place at a one-room schoolhouse, a really rural, really backwoods town where basically most of the students are adults.
Yeah. There's a few kids, but mostly,
and they're not grown-ups pretending to be kids. They're clearly adults. I mean, there's one guy with a mustache. I mean, these are, so it's like the whole.
A little surreal.
It's a little surreal, and
It is a little surreal, but it wasn't completely unusual for rural
schools. At least at this time.
Because our friend Eileen Bowser, who just passed away at 91, she mentioned being at a school, you know, when she was a child with older brothers and sisters and children of all kinds of different ages.
Yeah. So the idea of having, I'd say 2/3 of the classroom are grown-ups. So,
yeah.
So that'll explain some of the plot that happens. But the film is a lot of fun, and let's get right to it. Mona, will you get the lights?
I would love
to. All right, here we go. Here we go from 1918. Here is The Village Chestnut, starring Louise Fazenda and Chester Conklin. Here we go.
Thank you.
There you go.
Wow, that was exhausting.
Yes, and you were just watching.
I know.
Yeah, that was the village chestnut, or what survives of it. You can pretty much guess where it's going to wind up. I have a feeling that big puddle outside.
I think the puddle is a big
puddle. We've seen some of these. Yeah, so that is the village chestnut with Chester Conklin and Louise Fazenda. One of the things you can see in such a nice sharp print is that when Chester Conklin turns at an angle, you can see the line, the clown white that stops at the edge of his face,
yeah.
That you see in a lot of, when you see a really nice sharp print, you can see that this is the typical makeup that got carried over from the stage. But even with Stan Laurel in the films of the late 20s, he'll turn to the side and you'll see this, or Harry Langdon, this line of clown white that just stops right here.
You'll but see a tan neck, and then the jawline is white, you know, with the makeup.
Yes, Bonnie has a quick question. Yes.
I have a question. Was Louise Fazenda, was she the girl who was in love with the teacher?
Yeah, she's the one with the little spit curl.
Great clown.
She's really wonderful.
Yeah, she's a marvelous clown. She was one of Sennett's biggest stars in the teens and early 1920s.
Yeah.
She came from the stage. She didn't work much on the stage. She ended up in pictures in 1913, started as an extra at Universal, and quickly became part of their Joker comedies, where she was working with Max Asher and Gail Henry and Bobby Vernon and people like that. And she worked at Joker, where she played all kinds of characters. She'd play the young ingenue, but she would play character parts. And then in 1915, she ended up at Sennett at Keystone. And again, they used her for sort of an all-purpose character woman for a while. But pretty quickly, around 1916 into 1917, she started developing this kind of country girl character with the spit curl and the kind of the pigtails. And she's a marvelous actress. I mean, she always plays her roles very seriously. She has those luminous big eyes.
Yeah.
And she always puts a lot of emotion in her characters, but she's fully capable of doing all the knockabout with the guys. Like you see,
I was going to say, it kind of reminds me of Alice Howell, the way she wasn't worried about getting her dress dirty, and she had to fall in a vat of soapy water or whatever.
Yeah,
she just did it. She got hit in the head and threw things like everybody else.
And she really, you know, she was a very attractive woman, but she played these kind of unattractive characters. And she did say at the time in interviews that, you know, she doesn't mind people seeing her on film that way, but she didn't want her friends to come to the studio, you know, to see her doing these films and things.
Yeah.
But she was, like I said, she was one of Sennett's stars. She stayed with him through 1921, and then she moved on and did shorts for other companies, Jack White comedies, kind of continuing the same character. But after that, she became a supporting player in features, and she did that till 1939. And she's a really great character actress. She's in films like Footloose Widows. She's actually the star. She starred in a few features.
Yeah, that's a great film. That's a lot of fun.
It's
not famous or anything. Yeah.
No, it's not well known, but it's a prototype for the Gold Diggers films that Warner Brothers would do in the 1930s, except without the musical numbers because it's a silent film. But she's just a great character actress, and she was very good in the sound era. In 1927, she married the producer Hal Wallace, who wasn't a producer then, but he became a big producer for Warner Brothers and later produced the films of Jerry Lewis and Dean Martin and, you know, a lot of big pictures. And he was known in the industry as the prisoner of Fazenda. Some people say Billy Wilder came up with that, but he always claimed that he didn't say that. But that's what they were known as the industry. But in 1939, she retired, and she devoted the rest of her life to charity work.
Mm.
So she was supposedly like a really, really good person, and she did a lot of charity work. And then, of course, Chester Conklin was the other huge Sennett star. I mean, he's almost synonymous with Keystone films. He and Chaplin and Max Swain. And he had a likable character called Fishface. And then he had more of an unlikable character called Mr. Walrus. And I think we saw Mr. Walrus here.
Yeah.
Because he's not too likable. And usually, often he would be teamed with Max Swain as Ambrose. And they'd be kind of battling buddies, you know, where Chester was kind of conniving to take advantage of Ambrose. And this is definitely what you would call a knockabout comedy. Because
absolutely.
It's nonstop. Patty Maguire is sort of the prankster with the mustache. And we saw him last week in the haunted house. He's one the counterfeiters. But he, you know, again, he had supported, he came from the stage, from vaudeville. He supported Chaplin in his SNA comedies.
That's where I know his face from,
Then he moved to a company called Vogue and starred in a number of their films. He was a star. But then he moved over to Senate and became like a supporting player at Senate, which was a step up from Vogue because it was Max Senate, you know, who was the king of comedy at that time. Yeah. But his career tapered off in the early 20s. Myrtle Lind is the very attractive girl who was sort of Chester's favorite. And she had been a Max Senate bathing girl. And then she graduated to, you know, featured roles in films like that. And she retired in the early 20s. She married a banker. So she, you know, got out of pictures. But there's a lot of really great supporting people as well. The angry mother who comes in after Chester has spanked her son is Eva Thatcher. And she's in tons and tons of Senate films and educational comedies, Larry Seaman comedies. And she's in the Keaton feature College. She's the female dean of the women's college. She has quite a bit to do in that with Buster. And she's sort of Snitz Edwards' love interest in that. You know, the two of them together.
If you can imagine that.
If you can imagine.
Yeah.
But it's a really, you know, it's a crazy nonstop film. And at the end, you have Huey Mack, you know, big Huey Mack, running around on the ceiling, which is not something you want, you know. It's like a big trampoline, and it's just one of those wild and crazy. And the cops coming, and even the cops come in, but they keep repeating that shot of them in the car in the water.
Yeah.
So I could imagine at the end that the whole schoolhouse falls down or something.
Probably.
And they all end up like
puddle.
You said, in
right.
the puddle.
In the giant puddle, because they set it up twice already, so it's got to have a payoff somewhere.
It's just so crazy in the rain and
It's really a great example of again, you know, how far you can take logic and ignore it and just keep moving. And as long as you get to the next gag, you can just throw anything at the audience and just think like you're in a cartoon. Yes, Monica.
I also really appreciated all the real little kids in the background.
Yeah, the real kids,
that were in the schoolhouse, because they're clearly laughing their heads off.
They're having fun,
It looks like everybody's getting hurt, but clearly people were not getting
hurt.
And they were not censoring how funny it was to them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
No, and I mean, Louise even gets shot in the rear end with a lightning bolt.
It's just
crazy.
It's just everything.
What have we done next? Now, the directors, the directors of this short, it was two people are credited on this. One is a guy named Walter Wright, who had been a cameraman for Keystone, and he graduated becoming a director. He directed a lot of comedies with an actress named Ora Carew and Baldy Belmont. They were teamed in 1916, but he directed a lot of other stuff. But the other director is Raymond Griffith.
Well,
what?
Raymond Griffith. Yeah.
Who we know from Paths to Paradise and Hands Up.
You're
thinking of D.W. Griffith. This is Raymond Griffith,
right.
The guy with the silk hat and the little mustache. Well, no, if you are thinking we meant D.W. Griffith, we did. Raymond Griffith.
Very, very
popular comedian, made a lot of very successful features, most of which are missing, but he always played a very nattily dressed guy in an opera cape and a tuxedo, and nothing really bothered him.
Sophisticated. Very sophisticated. sophisticated comedy, which is why it's a surprise that he's co-director of this wild and crazy knockabout.
Yeah.
But he had been a vaudeville performer, and he ended up in pictures in the early teens, and he was sort of a headliner at LKO Comedies for a couple of years, you know, working with Alice Howell and people like that. And he worked at Triangle, and then he worked at Senate. And he's a performer in shorts like The Surf Girl and things like that. But he ended up moving behind the camera. He was a story guy for a long time, and he co-directed a couple of things like this. And I think he actually, for a while, was head of the Senate story department. But around 1921, 22, he started performing again.
And he also wrote a couple of the Douglas MacLean features. I think Going Up is one, but
he wrote as well.
And that's what got him connected partially with Paramount through the MacLean features.
Yeah. And then he started performing again, and he did supporting roles, and then Paramount starred him in his own features, which he did until the end of the silent era. He had diphtheria as a child, so his voice was a whisper. He couldn't speak above a whisper. But he did do two sound shorts for Al Christie where he played a character with a bad cold.
Yeah.
So he's sort of, you know, talking like this. But and his last performance was in All Quiet on the Western Front.
Yeah, it's a very touching moment.
He's a dying French soldier. He has a lot of scenes with Louise. And then after that, he went back to being a writer. And he became a producer. He was a good buddy of Daryl F. Zanuck because Zanuck had worked for him in the Senate story department. So Zanuck hired him to be a story guy and a producer, first at Warner Brothers and then 20th Century Fox. So he produced a number of films for a number of years and retired in the 1940s.
Yeah, so hopefully someday the Griffith films, Raymond Griffith comedies, will be available on home video. They aren't as yet, but they're definitely, you know, back when we get to go back to movie theaters, you can book them in 35mm from the Library of Congress and MoMA. They're really great.
He was really, I mean, his films were very forgotten, and they were rediscovered by Walter Kerr.
Yeah, and that's how I
wrote about
first
him
saw
in
them.
The Silent Clowns. He reestablished his reputation.
Yeah, so we want to thank the National Film Preservation Foundation, iFilm, the Library of Congress, and there's, like I said, there's more, tons more of rare silent film that's been preserved through this project available on the NFPF website.
I actually saw this film on nitrate when I visited Amsterdam in 2007. Hadn't been preserved yet, but I did see Village Chestnut on nitrate. Yeah. Among a lot of other things. It's really wonderful that it's been preserved and is available now.
And the iFilm Museum, as well as the National Film Preservation Foundation, are to be commended for making these films. It's not like they just posted it last week. I mean, this has been a multi-year project, and the iFilm Museum has a YouTube channel with tons of material. So they've really made a point of making these films available online. But now let's move on to our headliner short, starring Lupino Lane. This is something that we're presenting to you today through the courtesy of the Blackhawk Film Collection and Lobster Films. This was originally released.
Serge.
Thank you, Serge. This was released on the Slapstick Encyclopedia in the late 1990s, a series of DVDs that David Shepard produced, and it was released again as a box set. But a lot of people haven't seen this short, and it's a lot of fun. So you want to talk a little bit about Lupino Lane and what everyone's in store for?
I love Lupino Lane.
Yeah,
I'm so glad we're finally
talking
to him. Yay!
Well, the short, the Lupino Lane short that we have today is Only Me, and this is from 1929, and that's the whole point of the short. Lupino Lane plays all the characters in a vaudeville house. Here's a few of the characters. This is an ad from an item from the trade magazines, but he plays sort of the main character, this kind of drunken playboy who goes into the vaudeville theater, but then he plays all the different acts and everybody who works in the theater. So it's actually 24 different characters that he plays in this film. And he does have a little help from his brother, Wallace Lupino, who kind of fills in, you know, with his back to the camera, certain characters, you know, so they can have two characters. But it's a real tour de force for Lupino Lane, because he gets to make fun of all these different stage acts that he was very familiar with, because he spent his childhood in the British Music Hall. He was a star as a child. He was known as Little Nipper, and he was, you know, one of the big stars of the music hall for years. And he came to America and appeared in the Ziegfeld Follies and different shows over here, and you know, made various. He started making films in England in 1913, and when he was in the States in the early 20s, he did some films for Fox, and then after another trip back to the stage in 1925, he did a regular series for Jack White comedies that were distributed through Educational Pictures, and Only Me is part of that series, and it's actually near the very end, because it's 1929. He went on and made four sound shorts for Educational. And then actually in 1930, he went back to England. He'd made a great transition to sound. He's in The Love Parade, which is this wonderful Ernst Lubitsch film with Marie Chevalier and Jeanette MacDonald. But the family decided to go back to England. But this is a great film. And, you know, I think we should go ahead and take a look, and we'll talk more about Lupino Lane after the film.
Yeah, yeah, thanks, Steve. So this is Only Me. It's the name of the film, Only Me. And you, as you'll see, it may remind you of Keaton's The Playhouse or Charlie Chaplin's A Night in the Show. They're both similar, but this film gives Lupino Lane a lot more screen time to play at length the different characters and have fun with them. And you'll get to see his versatility as a clown and music hall performer. For those of you who are a little younger and don't know what we mean when we say music hall or vaudeville, before motion pictures and radio and television and the internet, this was a kind of show you would go to where there were a variety of different kinds of acts that would be maybe 10 or 12 minutes. And you knew if you were not interested in the opera singer, well, that would end in some other a juggler would come out. It's sort of what surfing YouTube is for us today, where you watch something for 4 or 5 minutes, okay, I'm done with it, and then, oh, I'll see something else. But the difference is that in vaudeville or the music hall, you would go in and you would sit there, and then you would be presented with a variety of acts, and they would be announced with the sign on an easel, one after another.
The circus is still kind of
Like the that. Circus is pretty much the closest thing to that still survives. And there are some before the pandemic and after it. There are groups of vaudeville and new variety performers like the Bendelstiff Open Stage Variety, which is on Monday nights on online, and many other projects that many performers and people like Travesty are involved with. But now let's just enjoy the film. Will you get the lights, please, Mona? Thank you. This is a film from 1929, Only Me. The main title and the intertitles were made much more recently, which is why they look a lot sharper than the rest of the film. But don't let that throw you. Here is Only Me. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's a tour de force.
Amazing.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much. That was Only Me from 1929, starring Lupino Lane, and in supporting roles, his brother Wallace Lupino. One of the things I enjoy about the film is that it's not just, oh, it's just a knockoff of the other films that we are very familiar with, but there's so much of his persona. I mean, it's him doing all of the acts, and you just see what a versatile performer he was, juggling fire.
I mean, you know, he was one of the great acrobats of the screen.
Yeah.
I mean, when you see him in his regular shorts where he plays kind of the befuddled everyman character that he, you know, sort of played, you see these incredible falls, and he does those tumbles where he completely flips over, and he'll even run up archways. There's a film made in Morocco where he's being chased in a Moroccan, you know, with these huge arches, and he runs up one side and down the other. It's absolutely amazing.
It's like a large doorway, and we a lot of us have watched it in slow motion. It's no trick. It's just he just knew he could do it. And I love that there's this scissor kick that he does rapidly several times. You think you see him do it at the end, just like, and he does it in a number of other films, like as a warning to other people before he attacks them. He'll just leap in the air over and over and over. Yeah.
In Roaming Romeo, he does it a lot. Where he was really amazing. But in this film, you don't see as much. I mean, you do see some of the acrobatics, but you get to see him make fun of satirize all the different acts on stage, which I think he was extremely familiar with from all his years spent on stage.
Yeah.
And also, the film is directed by Henry W. George, who was Lupino Lane.
Yeah.
His real name was Henry George Lupino. So Henry W. George, I think the W may stand for Wallace or something. Because that was his brother and co-star in a lot of these shorts. And you do get a little bit of a look at Wallace, especially when Lupino Lane is playing the little boy in the box, you know, who's throwing all the apples and tomatoes. And Wallace fills in as the uncle next to him. So you can kind of see him there, but it works very well.
You get a little bit of their, I only know it because I've seen them do it elsewhere, but in the wrestling match, there's this thing where they're ducking their heads, you know, in a different rhythm over and over. And it's something that he and Wallace do in a number of the other shorts, and it's something that
must have been part of their act.
There's a short called Hello Sailor and Goodnight Nurse.
Yeah.
You get to see the two of them at work together, and it's really wonderful.
Yeah, the great thing about Lupino Lane is that a number of his films do exist.
Yeah.
They're not all, you know, easy to see,
but
a lot of them are available, and they're really great. There is a DVD set that's going to be coming out for our friends Dave Glass and David Wyeth with some real rare titles of Lupino Lane.
Yeah.
But he's very looked... overlooked. The Lupino family was a huge theatrical family in England. You know, they'd been going on for decades and centuries, really. And his Ida Lupino was his second cousin. So they were all the Lupinos were related, and they, you know.
Yeah.
And they
stare at her long enough and squint real hard, you can kind of see the resemblance. Just a little bit,
And one of the films that we showed a few weeks ago starred his brother, Wallace, who we've mentioned.
The Lost Laugh,
And Ben and I knew Wallace's son, Richard. He lived here in New York. And I spent a lot of afternoons with Richard, and he talking about the history of the family. And we looked at, he had some of the films. Lupino Lane, after he went back to England, after he left Hollywood in 1930, he did numerous films in England and directed films. But in the late 30s, I think it was 1937, he premiered in what was his ultimate stage hit, Me and My Girl.
Yay. Yeah.
He did that all during World War II, and they even revived it again after. It did come to America later, but not really until Robert Lindsay started it on Broadway, I think.
That was in the 80s.
Yeah.
In the 80s, yeah. But that was a huge hit when it finally got to America. And he did make a film version of it in 1939 called Lambeth Walk, which is the big song the big number in the show is doing the Lambeth Walk. And they did make a film out of it, but like a lot of the film theater musicals, they took most of the musical numbers out of it.
Yeah.
But Richard had a copy.
It's a great show.
Yeah, it's a fun show.
Yeah, and I watched, you know, I watched the film with Richard, and Richard had been in some of the companies as a child. So he would tell me while we're watching it, he had a running commentary saying, oh, this number, they left this number out, but you hear the music as the underscore, the song that they cut and all this. So it would have made a great commentary track.
Yeah.
You know, to go with a release of the film. But the film hasn't really been seen, you know, hasn't really been available.
Yeah. I think there's a clip of the Lambeth Walk number that I've seen online.
There's also a clip online of them doing it live on television in 1939.
Right, because television started a lot earlier in England than it did in the U.S. So,
and this was
like a special presentation.
So
yeah,
they did,
it was either live or it was filmed
live.
For broadcast, and that version exists.
Yeah.
And I think that's what I'm thinking of seeing. And it, again, not really available, but it does exist. And so there is this, there is a motion picture record of him in the show that I don't know how, but could be seen at some point by somebody, I suppose. Yeah.
And people that had television at the time.
Yeah.
I suppose. But then they did do the film version, which was released, but it was lost during the war, I think because of the bombing in England. It was lost for a number of years, but it was found in a foreign archive. So
yeah.
it does exist.
Yeah. So we're so glad to be able to share with you this Lupino Lane film. And there are others. And there are people we know who have copies of them, and we will continue to find ways to bring more of Lupino Lane in the coming weeks and months as we go on our way through the various stages of the pandemic and coming out the other end at some point, hopefully next year. So that those are our films. But Steve, you have something to recommend for people while they're not watching our show to look at.
Yes, yeah. I have my Cabin Fever recommendation for this week, and it's a recent DVD set. It's Harry Langdon and Hal Roach, The Talkies, 1929 to 1930. And as you'll see there, it says featuring Thelma Todd, because she's in most of the shorts with Harry. You know, of course, Harry was one of the great silent clowns, and he had been doing his starring features, but the last couple didn't do very well. And but he went back to the stage, and then he made a comeback in sound films with this series for Hal Roach, which is a very unusual series.
Yes.
It's sort of pure Langdon. He talks all the time, but they're a fascinating group of films. And on this particular release, the first two, Hotter Than Hot and The Sky Boy, are shorts that really hadn't been available, and their soundtracks don't exist, but the scripts do. So they subtitled the image. They put the dialogue as subtitles on the film, and it works very well.
Cool.
And they're very visual anyway. So, you know, you really get to see the films, and most of the gags survive. But it's a really interesting set, and if you're a Langdon fan, it's really necessary. And there's some really nice extras. There's an introductory film that sort of introduces the series with Harry and Thelma Todd. And there's a Spanish language version of The Big Kick. So you get to hear Harry speak Spanish and babble in Spanish.
I haven't looked at the set. Is the head guy on this one?
Oh, yes.
The head guy has a couple of long babbling speeches of Harry's.
Oh,
that
one particularly are, long
that
monologue,
that
stream of consciousness monologue.
You really did wonder, was Beckett involved or not?
Wow.
it's a really surreal, unusual short, but it's still fun. And yeah, it's if you're a Langdon fan, and he's always just fun to watch move. And these shorts are now available for people to see, so that's great. I don't have a recommendation other than, you know, like I said at the top of the show, there's another 31 episodes, and if you need something to take your mind off everything that's going on this week,
they're all
on YouTube, and they're still accessible. So if you need it, it's there. If you've just found the show, We leave everything up so you can watch it later, so you can watch it after now, if I may use a line from the head guy. But mostly we're so glad you could come over for movie night or movie afternoon with us, or having us over to your place. Steve, any closing words from you?
I don't know. Did we want to mention camping out that we're?
Yeah, we can certainly mention as a teaser. One of the things that we do actually plan these shows out in advance, and one of the things that we wanted to let you know, we don't have a date set for it yet, but we will be screening the Roscoe Arbuckle or Fatty Arbuckle comedy Camping Out, which was made. During the time I think Keaton was in the Army.
Yeah, I think it came out in 1918, and yeah. Buster's not in it because he was in the Army at the time. Yeah.
But Camping Out is a film that was lost for many, many years. It was found and restored by the iFilmmuseum. We're grateful to the Elif Rung and Kanicha there and everybody at the iFilmmuseum. So we're working on a date for it, but the film is not available anywhere. Steve and I included it in the Arbuckle retrospective that we programmed together with Ron Magliozzi of MoMA in 2006, and it's been shown at a couple of festivals. But we're really pleased that we'll be able to share this film with you at some point later in the year.
Yeah, and it's a very good one, too. So it's really great.
Yeah, absolutely. So aside from camping out on the horizon...
I just want to thank everyone for tuning in, like always, every week. And I hope everyone stays well and, you know, we get through whatever turmoil happens this week. And, you know, hopefully get into some kind of smooth sailing. And I hope everyone stays well and we see you next week.
All right. All right, Steve. Thank you. Thanks so much, Steve.
Thanks, Steve.
That's our episode. That's episode 32 of the Silent Comedy Watch Party. I'm Ben Modell. I'm so glad we could visit today, and together with my wife Mona here and from our apartment, Steve and his wife Susan from their place. This is really until I know some cinemas are reopening with limited seating, but pretty much for a little while, this is the closest we'll all get to attending a silent film show with live music, and I'm so glad. We're able to do this. I figured out all the wires and USB cables, and the folks at Mimo Live, the software that I'm using, I thank them for answering questions helping me out with this. But we're really grateful to you. Yes, Mona.
And thanks to the 3,200 people that watched our show from last week.
Yeah.
That was amazing.
That was a much larger number than usual. We're so glad that you found the show, that you've discovered the show. We hope you enjoy today's broadcast, and we'll be back again. We are, if you're, again, so inclined and so moved to throw a couple of bucks in our tambourine, we are set up online for that through Square and PayPal, Patreon, and Venmo. And there's information on silentcomedywatchparty.com on how to set all of that up. We're here for you. We want to thank the folks at the Garden of Silence website for the interview they did with me and Steve that's just been posted. And thanks to
Is
all
that
of you.
The one in Italian?
That's the one that's Italian, Italian and English. And we want to thank you all of you who sent in pictures of your screen and your snacks and your setup, and for telling us your stories about how these wonderful films have brightened your day and your week. We'll see you again live on YouTube right here on the Silent Comedy Watch Party next Sunday and every Sunday. For the foreseeable future, I'm Ben Modell. Thanks for watching.
Thanks
get the lights.
For watching,
I'll pull you off into the rest of whatever your day is. Thanks again.
Have a wonderful week.
Stay safe. Stay safe. Stay healthy, and keep laughing. We'll see you next time. Thanks again for watching the Silent Comedy Watch Party right here on YouTube. We'll see you next week. Thanks so much for watching.